Hi everyone, I'm Lavanya and today I'm going to present the topic Big Data Privacy along with my co-presenters Sheldon Vedangi and Amritpa. So before directly coming over to Big Data Privacy, let's see what Big Data is. You might be thinking that Big Data is a data which is very big. So partially you are correct. Big Data is a data which is very huge, gathered from various resources and comes in different formats, structured, unstructured, or even semi-structured, which is then analyzed, investigated, and then used for strong decision making. So big data alone is of no use until and unless some knowledge has been put to it in order to generate certain decisions out of it. And this is not an overnight concept, but traditionally it was really very hard to analyze big data. Thus, Mr. Dong Lene in 2000 gained this term big data, where he described its characteristics among three V's, that is volume, huge volume of data that has been generated from various resources, velocity, which is directly linked with the time consumed in processing the data, variety, that it comes in various formats, whether it's organized, unorganized, or even semi-organized. Then, with the use of SAS, two supplementary measures have been introduced, which is variability, that the data, big data, is dynamic enough and can mold itself according to the given situation and the objectives need to be fulfilled at that particular time, and veracity, which is directly linked with the quality of the data. The significance of analyzing big data is not limited to the amount of data being used, but what is this data being used for? Thus, its significance involves developing client assimilation, which involves the transparency of the data which is used by the client. 100% transparency is there, that as to what data they need to analyze. Recognize and alleviate scams, which means certain measures are taken in order to ensure that the changes in the trends are even or not. And if there are any discrepancies, certain measures are taken in order to stop them. Running supply chain productivity, increasing the productivity by measuring each and every process of supply chain, whether excessive cost is there, more time is there, and then certain sensors, tracking gadgets can be put in order to avoid those barriers. The working of big data involves a certain action plan which is prepared, then diagnosing the resources, after that approaching, supervising and storing the data. The stored data is then analyzed and then certain decision making have been done to that analyzed data. It is often said that great opportunities comes with great risk involved in it. So, be it be unstructured data, data preservation, cost consuming, inadequate analysis, and the hottest topic, that is data privacy. So what data privacy is? Data privacy is concerned with how and what kind of data has to be used and what should be disclosed and what not, so that certain data should not act as a weapon against that organization, because maybe that organization has stored or put their data for some other purpose, but someone is misusing it for their own benefit, which is keeping the company's position at stake, which is very wrong. So, the regulatory acts such as the General Data Protection Regulation Body, which is used in the European Union and its economic area, ensures that certain data should be maintained and the users of the data, whether the individuals or the organization, should be flexible enough and should have that flexibility so that they can decide what data should be disclosed and what should be kept confidential. More light on this topic will be thrown by Vedangi. I'm just sharing it to her.
Thank you, Lavanya. Now I'm going to discuss about the needs of privacy and security in big data. The another thing is privacy challenges in big data. Third one is the privacy requirement in big data. And the fourth one is privacy versus security. The first, the need of the privacy and security in big data. That is in big data analytics, it is a wide range of advantage, but also some impacts are there. So for that, we use the privacy and security. Privacy challenges in big data. Now, what is the privacy challenges in big data? We face lots of challenges during nowadays. The first one is anonymization may become impossible. First, the consumer face challenges and balance act with the label. They provide high security and solutions, so anonymization become impossible. The second one is growing risk of security breaches. In that, One report suggests that in 2040, almost 110 million people affected by security breaches. This is serious concern about the risk of security breaches. The third one is intentional discrimination. In intentional discrimination, the last year White House report suggests that big data can create the risk of unintentional discrimination. The fourth one is big data analytics may not be entirely accurate. Nowadays, all the brands use big data and their outsells. So sometimes it not correctly or not it is accurate. What is the challenges in big data? The first one is lack of anonymization. Second is privacy breaches. Third one is discrimination. Fourth one is legal protection. Fifth is in ethical actions. Fifth one is irrelevant patterns and copyrights. Next one is improper data masking. The another one is insufficient analytics. The another one is e-discovery concern. What is privacy requirement in big data? Like, another interesting point is privacy requirement in big data. Big data analytics decide that not to use such services because of privacy tool. The privacy and growth method of frameworks are the privacy policy specification for handling data access stored on the target data platforms. The second one is generation of successful completion supervisor. And the third one is integrating the produce monitors on the platform of target analytics. In this, privacy is on a high risk. So for that, they make standardized method and research techniques to describe for that. So they make ETL process. What the ETL process are describing in this image? There are four steps of ETL image. The data in server, MapReduce process validation, ETS process validation and report testing. The another interesting point is privacy and security. What is privacy and security? Privacy is harder to define. That is a part of unspecific users, while security is referred to protection against the unauthorized access of data. Privacy and security collect. Privacy is collection of personal information, data quality, then access to personal information and using and disclosing personal information, where the security is confidentiality, integrity and availability. Thank you. Now I would like to pass it on to Sheldon.
Thank you, Vedangi. Now that we know what data privacy is and how it's different from security, let's discuss a few methods and techniques used to preserve the data privacy across big data and analytics. So as you know, real-time analytics deals with collecting data from various sources, ingesting, storing, processing the data, analyzing and visualizing it, and all this while using a specific framework like Hadoop, MapReduce or Spark, so that we can process huge amounts of data in a distributed computing environment. The privacy of data has to be preserved across this big data spectrum, and this architecture is broken down into data management and analytics. So before we can get into the analytics part of it and derive meaningful insight from the data management process acquires this data, generates it, stores it, and processes it so that it can be retrieved for analysis. It is very important that data privacy be preserved from the data management phase itself. And this phase of data management is broken down into three stages: data generation, data storage, and data processing. So when we talk about data generation, it's done in two ways: active data generation and passive data generation. Active data generation, where the data owner willingly shares his data, or passive data generation, where it's discreetly collected by a third party through online activities like browsing the internet, clicking on advertisements, etc. The tools or the methods used here to preserve data is falsifying data and access restriction. So an access restriction is basically where the data owner has the option to refuse sharing his data if he or she is of the impression that it may contain some sensitive information which should not be shared. And certain tools used here are encryption tools, script blockers, etc. When we talk about falsifying data, we mean disrupting or altering the data a bit so that the true meaning cannot be revealed in case it contains sensitive information. And certain tools used here are sock puppet, which basically makes it look to the collector that there are many people who have the same data, or mask me, which is used for financial transactions over the internet. Moving on to data storage, basically the security mechanisms used are certain levels of security and encryption, like file level, media level, application level, security and encryption. When we talk about data storage, we have to talk about data storage on the cloud. Data storage on the cloud is three-dimensional. CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. When we talk about data privacy, we have to focus on confidentiality and integrity. It's very important to verify the integrity of data when it is being stored on the cloud. And this can be done through with certain tools like checksums, message authentication code, digital signatures, which were all taught to us during the networking subject as well last semester. The certain tools used to preserve data storage is homomorphic encryption, which is attribute-based encryption, which where the ciphertext is totally dependent on one specific attribute, like an address, for example. Then we have secure multi-party computation, where there are multiple parties carrying out calculating functions in a distributed cloud environment, but they only have access to their own inputs and their own results. Other methods used to preserve data in this stage are hybrid clouds, which use different kinds of cloud platforms together with an organizational between each platform and storage path encryption. Moving on to data processing, data privacy is preserved in two phases in data processing. It's done through by preventing unwanted disclosure of any sensitive information. And the next phase is extracting meaningful insights while preserving the privacy of the data owner. Moving on to the next topic, let's talk about privacy preservation or data privacy preservation in data mining, which is very important. There are a number of techniques that are used to preserve privacy in data mining, and they can be broadly classified as input privacy and output privacy. And under each of these headers, there are other methods that are used. So starting off with input privacy, basically it deals with anonymization of the published data, making it anonymous. So we don't reveal the true identity of the source. And it mainly deals with generalization and suppression of data. To give you an example, if you want to show an age as 19, you would make it look as less than or equal to 20. And for suppression, we mean certain attributes are signified with an asterisk mark. So the three methods that come under de-identification are K-anonymity, L-diversity, and T-closeness. So all of these deal with generalization and suppression of data, and each of them was introduced due to the limitations of the previous one. Moving on to the next input privacy, it's differential privacy, which uses an intermediary software known as a privacy guard between the users accessing information from the database. So the user requests for information from the database through the intermediary software, and the intermediary software distorts the data a little bit before delivering the results back to the user. Moving on to output privacy. Output privacy is basically when the output of the results are distorted or disturbed a little bit, and they are audited to preserve the privacy. So methods used here are association rule mining, query auditing, classification accuracy, and basically it just deals with making sure that the results are disturbed, but not too much. Just enough that it still makes the same meaning or same sense. Now, there are certain formulas, because it disrupts the data, there are certain formulas that have been kept in place to check for the data quality. Because as I said, the data is being disrupted a little bit, it needs to make sure it makes the same meaning or it has the same sense. So there were certain techniques or formulas that were implemented to check for data quality. Now, though all these data mining techniques under input-output privacy were effective, they could not deal with the enormous voluminous big data or the ever-increasing size of big data. And they could not deal with the scalability of big data, which is very important. So because of that, there was an introduction of a combination of frameworks like MapReduce or Spark, combined with one of these techniques to form a better data privacy preservation technique. And many of them were introduced through different research papers in different fields like healthcare, biomedical research, Internet of Things, etc. So just to go through a few of them, some of them include noise generation, which is the basic concept of hiding a needle in the haystack. And it uses this algorithm called the a priori algorithm with a MapReduce framework. Then we have differential privacy, which we spoke about, protection of body area networks in the big data environment, cryptographic techniques with anonymization techniques. So it's a combination of cryptography and anonymization, then local recoding anonymization and MapReduce for data privacy preservation on the cloud. And others use big data privacy for the Internet of Things era. There's differential privacy and cryptographic techniques, which was basically researched and introduced for biomedical research. And another one is HyperX, which is preserving security and privacy for healthcare data. What we'll do is now we'll move on to Amritpal Singh, who will give you a few more details about data privacy with the Internet of Things. Over to you, Amritpal.
Sheldon, I am Amritpal Singh. Today, I am talking about big data in the era of IoT and privacy concerns. Next is best practice of the data privacy. Strike a balance, big data privacy versus big data usefulness. Next is big data in the era of IoT. What is Internet of Things? The Internet of Things is a network of networks in which typically a massive numbers of objects are connected through the information and communications. Privacy concern in the era of IoT. First is user context acquisitions. In the IoT, user context is about acquiring the required amount of data from the users and unusers. Next is control, communications, and freedom of choice. In the IoT, the data owner must have full control of data, allowing the users to delete and update the data. Third is promises and reality. Each of IoT solutions promises after a selected number of functionalities. This is achieved by the service provided by the required of data. Fourth is security. Even though detailed discussion on IoT security is out of scope of article, it is important to mention the standardizations and certification would be foundation of security. Next topic is best practices of data privacy or in data privacy. What is data privacy? Data privacy is a information of data privacy is a branch of data security concerned with the proper handling of data, notice and regulation and obligations of data. First is make it a two-way conversations. Privacy can become way of engage, means they are compared to the two peoples to make is a conversation to the one people to the another people and one department to the another department. Practices robust data security. Privacy covers many areas including the ability of choose of share of data. However, to apply these choices to protect the underlying data security, measures need to be implemented. Third is encourage education and awareness. Education on security and privacy issues is not just about your employees becoming security aware you. Fourth is practices minimum data collections. So next is strike a balance big data privacy versus big data usefulness. Strike a balance between big data privacy and big data usefulness to help you create a better way to implement data governance in a big data world. There are three steps in the big data usefulness versus big data privacy. First is implement business rules on big data. By making business rules part of your IT infrastructure, you get operational and workflow control across the enterprise. Second is know your boundaries. Check your quality of your source data before putting it into the production and on the systems. Third is create privacy and levels. Review the standard and use the filters in the data. Here it's important to understand what record filters can do for you and how to apply these filters for a given uses of data of service insight approach. Thank you so much. I would like to recommend Mr. Sheldon. He will discuss about the case study of the data privacy. Thank you.
Thanks, Amritpal. So before we end this presentation, I just wanted to share with you a short case study that included issues of data privacy. This is a very popular documentary on Netflix known as The Great Hack. So it includes Cambridge Analytica, a political data firm that was hired by President Trump during the 2016 elections. So this company actually gained access to private information of more than 50 million Facebook users. And it offered tools that could identify personalities and traits of American voters and influence their behavior. This information included identities of the Facebook users, their friends, and their likes. So the intention was to map out personality traits based on the people and their likes on Facebook and use that information to target and influence their audiences through digital ads. And it asked them to take a survey through an app, and then it scrapes personal information off their profiles. So this technique was developed by Cambridge University, but they declined and they denied to go ahead with this plan. But a certain Russian-American psychology professor, Alexander Kogan, from the university, actually agreed to go ahead with it and ended up building the app, harvesting that data for Cambridge Analytica. He ended up ultimately providing over 50 million user profiles for the firm. And out of all those people, only 270,000 people actually consented the permission to actually harvest their data. But they were all of the impression that it was for academic use. So researchers have access to this kind of information through Facebook, but it's strictly for academic purposes because Facebook prohibits this kind of data being used for monetization related services or any ad related brokerage services. And that is exactly what Dr. Kogan did by providing this information to the consulting firm Cambridge Analytica, which actually used this to influence people's votes during the Trump elections. So Facebook acknowledged that it acquired the data, but at the same time, they blamed Dr. Kogan for using it in the wrong way and actually insisted that he delete all this information. When Facebook learned about this, they had Dr. Kogan's app removed off the Facebook network and demanded that the data be destroyed, so much so that they hired a forensic firm to determine the accuracy and the claims that if the data still exists. But there are claims that till now copies of this data still exist. So through this case study, we can actually get a clear understanding of how important and how serious of a matter data privacy is. I hope you all enjoyed this presentation. On behalf of Lavanya and Vidangi, Amritpal and myself, thank you for listening and have a nice day.